गुड मॉर्निंग फ्रेंड, यू आर मोस्ट वेलकम टू थिंक आइज चैनल। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस कंपरेटिव एथनोग्राफी, इन विच वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस इंट्रोडक्शन टू एथनोग्राफी। नाउ इंट्रोडक्शन, द फर्स्ट ब्लॉक इंट्रोड्यूस यू टू एथनोग्राफी बोथ एज अ मेथड ऑफ रिसर्च एंड प्रेजेंटेशन ऑफ डिफरेंट कल्चर्स। द टर्म एथनोग्राफी इज अ कॉम्बिनेशन ऑफ टू ग्रीक वर्ड्स, एथनोज मीनिंग फोक और पीपल एंड ग्राफो मीनिंग टू राइट। एथनोग्राफी hence may be understood as a qualitative account or description of cultures and lifestyle of communities. In anthropological parlance, however, ethnography acquires a particular salience in that it foregrounds prolonged in-depth fieldwork and participant observation. The enterprise of ethnography is not, however, confined to these. What constitutes the core of ethnography is, as Clifford Geertz mention, thick descriptions. The first unit begins with the developing an understanding of the nature and scope of ethnography. It traces the trajectory of ethnography from its very roots in the British and Chicago schools. This followed by critical methodological concerns and an account of how ethnographic studies are actually carried out in the field. In the present age of globalization, the concept of cultural community, which has formed the cornerstone of ethnographies, has undergoes transformation which calls for revisiting the whole notion of ethnography as a process and product of intensive fieldwork and participant observation. Concomitant with this is the emergence of new trends in ethnography, one of which is multi-sited ethnography that are explained towards the end of this unit. The second unit carries forward the understanding on the nature and scope of ethnography to critically examine the different ways and means of viewing cultural communities and theoretical discussion that inform ethnographic writings. The undermining of scienticism in social sciences in a general sense marked a blow to positivist ethnographic accounts that were often based on detached observation and participation in people's culture and employed neutral language in the writing about them, coincided largely with the collapse of colonialism. The end of the colonialism marked a significant change in social relationship between, as Geertz puts in this famous book, in his famous book Work and Lives, Anthropologist as Author, 1988, between these who ask and look for and those who are asked and looked at. This ensued a kind of crisis of representation which necessitated exploitation of alternative ways of understanding cultures and lifestyles of people by ethnographers. Expectedly, new forms of ethnographies emerged. The unit draws attention to at least four kinds of ethnographic writings and explain how accounts of other cultures are presented as ethnographies in different ways. In effect, the unit focuses on the praxis of ethnographic writings. The third unit deals with ethics, which is an extremely important issue in the practice of both carrying out an ethnographic study and writing an ethnography. There is a need for discussion of ethical issues in ethnographic research and writing in order to obviate situations of suspicion and or fear among the cultural communities and maintain the integrity of the research and his or her research. The unit discusses several ethical issues, all of which center around relations between the ethnographies, anthropologist and the people. This block will enable you to appreciate how social anthropologists make sense of other cultures and what it is like to experience daily life in initially unfamiliar cultures. Now we are going to start Unit 1, Nature and Scope of Ethnography. Introduction: history and development of ethnography, in which we are discussing beginnings of ethnography, a specialized skill for social science research, essential of ethnography, methodologies, concerns. Third is new trends in ethnography. At the last summary, learning objectives are This unit will help the students to understand the relevance of ethnography in anthropological studies, history and development of ethnography, and emerging trends in ethnographical studies. Now we are going to discuss about the introduction part. In simplest term, ethnography is the systematic description in a contemporary of a contemporary culture through fieldwork. In loose and broad sense, the goal of ethnography is to provide a detailed, in-depth description of everybody's life and everyday lives and practice of a people. Many scholars refer to it as thick description, a term attributed to Clifford Greed's 1973, who was developing the idea of an interpretive theory of culture in 1970s. From another angle, the term ethnography has come to be equated with virtually any qualitative research project. Thus, traditionally speaking, ethnography may be described as the best tool of qualitative research in anthropology, whose aim is cultural interpretation. Thus, an ethnographer is supposed to go beyond reporting events and details of experience, but to attempt to explain how these represent webs of meanings, a phrase borrowed from Geertz 1973. As rightly suggested by Bernard and Spencer 1996, the word ethnography has a double meaning: ethnography as product, ethnographic writings, and ethnography as process, participant observation or fieldwork. The product depends upon the process, but not in any simple relationship. In constructing ethnographies, anthropologists do more than merely writing up the field notes they record as part of process of doing fieldwork. If ethnographies can be seen as a building blocks and testing grounds of anthropological theory, ethnographies and the ethnographic process from which they derive are also shaped and molded by theory. As a category of anthropological research, ethnography is characterized by the first-hand study of a small community or ethnic group. Such studies combine to a varying degree descriptive and analytical elements, but the cultural characteristics of conventional ethnographies is that they focus on one specific culture or society and consider theoretical or comparative generalization from the standpoint of the ethnographic example. Macmillan's Dictionary of Anthropology, 1986. Interestingly, anthropologists have generally paid little explicit attention to ethnographies as text, often treating ethnography as a synonymous with fieldwork or as a method rather than a product of research. History and development of ethnography. When we look at the history of ethnography and anthropology, we find that it has complex intellectual roots in the Enlightenment and the European discoveries of non-Western peoples. Empiricism or empirical tradition was a byproduct of this historical development. The pioneering anthropologists were not field researchers and were basing their conclusions on secondary sources. They may be described as armchair anthropologists, but the later developments helped develop the tradition of fieldwork, and that is how ethnography became a part and parcel of anthropological field research. Before moving further, let us refer to the work of young French philosopher Joseph Marie de Grandot, who, according to Peltot and Peltot 1997, wrote the first field guide for ethnographers. His consideration on the various methods to follow in the observation of savage people was intended as a guide for members of the Society d'Observateurs d'L. Homme, that is the book, as they embarked on expeditions to Africa and Australia. De Grandot's 1969 discussed the principal weaknesses in the ethnographic observation of earlier explorers and argued that the first means to a proper knowledge of the savages is to become like one of them, and it is by learning their language that we shall become their fellow citizen. He was especially clear about the importance of studying primitive people within the context of their social system. He gave detailed suggestions concerning ethnographic observations, but his excellent fieldwork instructions had little effect on the French explorers. The long forgotten suggestions of De Grando and the earlier ethnographic work provide us with the perspective from which to view contemporary ethnographic activities, Peltu and Peltu Ibid. Bernald and Spencer's Ibid points out that ethnographies, as they have evolved over the past centuries and a half, constitute a genre, a form of writing conditioned by the process of knowledge construction, epitomized in the anthropological triangle, process or product comparison and contextualization. Ethnographies consequently differ from travel writing, gazetteers, interview-based surveys, or even the personal fieldwork accounts for anthropologists, which form a separate genre. Ethnography, both as product and process, has a history and pattern of the development of its own. Beginning of ethnography as a specialized skill or social science research. British and Chicago School of Ethnography. As already stated, ethnography has a distinguished career in social sciences. There have been travelers' tales for centuries, which may be counted as the earliest form of ethnography, as these purported to represent the social or cultural reality through contact with and observation of a country, culture, or a group. However, ethnography began properly during the 20th century as a result of two independent intellectual developments, British and the other North American. These may also be described as the British and Chicago School of Ethnography. The former was a product of the emergence of the classical tradition of social anthropology in Britain, and the latter as Chicago sociological tradition. The British school had close association between social anthropology and British colonialism, while social anthropology is no longer associated with colonialism. Its origins were tied to the needs of the British Empire to understand the cultures and peoples it was seeking to rule once the period of colonial conquest was completed. While social anthropology is no longer associated with colonialism, its origins were tied to the needs of the British Empire to understand the cultures and peoples it was seeking to rule once the period of colonial conquest was completed. While Tyler and Morgan were the first influential writers on the subject of ethnography, it is Malinowski who is credited to have single-handedly contributed to the ethnographic methods. The second school is related with the University of Chicago, which dominated the intellectual and professional landscape of sociology from the last quarter of 19th century until the 1940s. The popular phase of core Chicago ethnographies is justified by the fact that these were conducted by sociologists affiliated with the University of Chicago. Each one of them analyzed everyday life, communities, and symbolic interaction characteristics of the specific group. The doctoral students of Robert Park and Ernest Berger produced these ethnographies. They generated a vital picture of urban life grounded in local studies and sympathetic eye on human behavior. Their contribution to scholarship and reflective society are now considered as classics throughout the world. These are popularly referred to as the Chicago style ethnographies. These descriptive narratives portrayed social worlds experienced in the everyday life within modern, often urban context. In these accounts, social change, especially disorganizing and rapid changes in values and attitudes, was the main area of concern. These studies generally use more statistical data, combining them with a series of qualitative techniques such as interviews, face-to-face interactions, and life histories. Later, the urban focus was extended to the rural settings. Methods and techniques. The methods and techniques of many 19th century ethnographers suffered from the pervasive evolutionist theory, leading to a neglect of the contemporaneity of cultures they were studying. The reconstruction of history as a major goal of ethnography endured into the early years of the 20th century. With the advent of Bronislaw Malinowski and the others, the amateur history-oriented ethnography was eclipsed. This happened because of the rise of interest in an historical, structural, functionalist study of social system. This reorientation may largely be attributed to the theoretical works by A.R. Radcliffe Brown and Bronislaw Malinowski. The origin of the modern ethnographic research tradition is generally traced to Malinowski, who, as a part of his functionalist theory of society, stressed the primacy of field research and participant observation, and to Frangebois, who, like Malinowski, reacted against the speculative history of evolutionary theory and advocated the careful description of specific cultures. Thus, ethnography in both American culture anthropology and British social anthropology from the post-war periods onward acquired generally a historical perspective concentrating on the reconstruction of a specific cultural or social systems without regards to its historical development and historical consideration. Moreover, there is also a clear methodological advantage involved in the synchronic study of social life. Thus, the ethnographic present became the dominant style. Anthropology grew out of the intersection of European discovery, colonialism, and natural science. All of these plays their role in reshaping ethnographies in one way or the other, along with the intellectual roots in Enlightenment. In the early part of the 20th century, anthropology was typically concerned with the small-scale, technologically simple societies. In part, this was out of a desire to record ways of life that were rapidly changing with the advent of colonialism. Although it would be a mistake to assume that these societies were somehow unchanging or even truly isolated before their contact with the West, and in part it was out of a desire to get the essential or elementary forms of human institutions, J. Monaghan and Peter Just, 2000. Reflection. Bronislaw Caspar Malinowski, 1884-1942, was born in Krakow, Poland, and settled in Great Britain in 1910. His basic training was in the mathematics and physical science, but he turned to ethnology because of sheer interest and established himself as a theoretical anthropologist. He carried out his path-breaking and legendary fieldwork in the Trobriand Islanders between 1915-1918, on the basis of which he published a number of books based on his works. This work, it includes such classic ethnographies as Argonauts of the Western Pacific, Crime and Custom in Savage Society, and Sexual Life of the Savage in Northwestern Melanesia. Through his ethnographic works, he raised the status of the field work in anthropology to an art or craft. His skill in doing field work through participant observation gave a new dimension to anthropological field work. Essentials of ethnography. Modern ethnographic field work involves living in close contact with the population in order to observe their daily routine, rituals and social acts, economic activities and other aspects of cultural behavior. This could be possible through the participant observation. Malinowski is often credited with being the originator or at least the major developer of this style of fieldwork that involves intensive and long-term immersion in the daily lives of native people. Though some anthropologists before Malinowski conducted fieldwork through native language, spent substantial time in the field and in the process got involved emotionally with the people they studied, yet it was Malinowski who raised the ethnographic fieldwork to the status of an art or craft. The ethnographer Frank Cushing lived for about 5 years, 1880 to 1885, with Zuni Pueblo, participating in the life of the people, but the strong emphasis on participant observation owes much to Malinowski. As the main technique of an ethnographer, participant observation involves living with the people one studies. He or she learns their language and through it learns about their belief and behavior. The ethnographer participates as he or she observes. Much of his or her research is therefore based on subtle interference that he or she derives from informal situations. The ethnographer may interview formally for a particular kind of information or may use questionnaires, psychological tests, or other standardized and relatively rigorous techniques. But regardless of what other methods one may be following, he or she is always alert to record the events going on around him or her and understand their significance for particular problems for his or her general understanding of the life of the people. Thus, the ethnographer himself or herself is the most important instrument, and the value of the work depends on his or her participating broadly in the life of his or her host and sensitivity observing what is happening around him or her. Methodological concern. We have to keep several things in mind when we look at the ethnographer at work. This practice of ethnography is not an easy job. It is more likely that a fieldwork may make all kinds of mistakes. We have to identify the pitfalls to avoid these. When the techniques of participant observation requires living like the people, the field worker must maintain flexibility, humility and sensitivity. Establishment of the personal rapport is a precondition for successful ethnography. Acceptance of the local personal rapport is the acceptance of the local food and drink is very important. Many ethnographers have reported that their acceptance of local food and drink was the first step to rapport establishment. Sharing food and eating with the population under study immediately brings dividends. It may pose a lot of problems for such ethnographers who are quite rigid and stubborn about accepting food other than their own. It may also involve the question of hygiene and sanitation. A strictly vegetarian and teetotaler ethnographer would be in trouble in such situations. Smoking poses problems for non-smokers. Participation in local social scene is also a great significance in participant observation. Most of the ethnographers have been following Malinowski's advice of taking part in day-to-day activities of the people one studies. One has to leave all the gadgets, pen, pencil, camera, voice recorder, etc. on such occasions. The notes may be taken later by recollecting the events and experiences. Through participation in activities, the field worker sends the signals that he wants to be identified as the insider. Yet there are always a number of the areas of activities where an outsider's participation or even presence may not be considered desirable. Activities related with religion and ritual obviously come under this category of activities. However, evidence of authoritarian and judgmental behavior is the prerequisite for good ethnography. Here comes the role of cultural relativism, the idea that a culture should be understood in its context. There are no universal standards according to which a culture is judged. This idea has led to respect for all cultures. Some anthropologists look at friendship as a strategy for fieldwork. This should not be taken as a strategy which sounds selfish. This must be a genuine feeling of friendship, which sometimes lead to a situation where the ethnographer may also become a medical aid for the people one studies. This happens when the ethnographer carries medicines for personal use, which may also be used for the people if need arises. The ethnographer must ensure that he or she does not betray the friendship formed during fieldwork. In the process, ethical questions are also to be encountered. Reflection. Ethnography and question of ethics. Ethnography poses a number of questions concerning ethics. An ethnographer has no control over who will make use of data and for what purpose. There is also the problem of privacy. An ethnographic account may be dealing with the private and sensitive matters of the people. What would happen to the privacy of informants? One has to decide about how much of sensitive information has to be included in the report. In other culture studies, participant observation is never easy and the initial stages are the most difficult. These are the problems of living with the strangers. The ethnographer must earn the cooperation and confidence of the people he wishes to study. In this task, he must develop friendly and genuine respect for the culture of the people he studies. It also involves the difficult task of impression management. Though most of the ethnography work done by the anthropologist involves simple societies or peasantry, but from the second half of the 20th century, a number of the ethnographic work concerning urban population have begun to appear. Lebo's Tally Corner, 1968, Keezer's The Voice Lord, 1969, Patty's The View from the Barrio, 1968, and Nash, A Community in Limbo, 1970, are some such studies. Oscar Labbe's work, Under the Banner of the Cultural Poverty, La Vida, and Children of Sanchez, are famous studies of urban poverty in slums. A number of anthropologists have also published their experiences in ethnographic research. Henry N. Saberwall, 1969, in Stress and Response in Fieldwork, gives interesting analysis of psychological and social aspect of the ethnographer's experience. Goldie, 1970, in Women in the Field, describes special role conflicts, problems and advantages experienced by female ethnographers. Such narratives sometimes paint the picture of an ethnographer as marginal native. The end product of an ethnographic exercise is the text, which purports to deal with objective facts, which means that the text is the result of a serious process of objectivization and ultimate product of a complex interaction between self and the other. The convention of fieldwork has some inherent problems that eventually lead to the problem of subjectivity, however careful the ethnographer might be, and whatever precautions he might take to be objective and free from the prejudice, There is possibility of subjectivity unconsciously creeping into ethnography. Mishra 2009. It should be realized that the fulcrum of fieldwork is essentially a human equation, an equation between the researcher and the informant. Since the anthropological fieldwork is carried out with people, it has to be collaborative in essence and spirit. In this collaborative exercise, the researchers and his promise to be objective constitute only one half of the possibility of ethnography being free from subjective consideration, as the other half depends entirely on the informants and their resolute commitment to share only objective realities with the researchers. Therefore, it is evident that the outcome of fieldwork depends not only on the skills and motivations of the researchers, but also on the behavior of the informants. As far as the time duration of good or ideal ethnographic fieldwork is concerned, it should be at least one calendar year. This gives an opportunity to the ethnographer to interact with the respondents in different parts of the year, as the activities vary from season to season. Thus, the behavior of the people under study in different seasons may be understood. Moreover, a weakness in many ethnographies is that they are derived largely from male informants. This weakness comes from the fact that mostly anthropologists are male, and hence they find it easier and more acceptable in the local community to work with other males. The problem is further compounded by the fact that men are dominant in almost all societies and tend to monopolize the researchers' time and attention. The presence of the anthropologist's wife or husband and even his children can facilitate entry into segments of society that would otherwise be difficult to deal with. Writing the ethnography is a crucial part of any anthropological work. Anthropology Today 1971 provides prudent and workable guidelines. It says that before the ethnographer can present his or her collection of data in written form, one must analyze the significance of his or her findings. The analysis is the process by which an ethnographer moves from the many observations that had been recorded to the generalized statement about his or her observations might imply. The analysis actually begins before the first observations are made. Moreover, the theoretical problems and interests the researcher develops before one enters the field determine, in an important way, the sort of findings that will be made by directing ethnographic attention towards some phenomena and away from others. It is impossible to observe everything, however, there will always be selective observation. In scientific ethnography, this selection is guided by explicit theory. Anthropology, like all learning, is a social enterprise. Results are cumulative and every study is strengthened by what has been learned in previous studies. When modern anthropology took shape in the early years of the 20th century, there were still large areas that had hardly been visited by Europeans and were much less subjected to systematic exploration. When Boas studied Indians on the west coast of North America, when Malinowski lived in the Tobriand Islands, when Bateson visited the Iatmul in New Guinea, and when Ivan Pritchard went to live among the Azande, they could only to a limited extent prepare themselves through reading earlier studies of the same people. They knew comparatively little about the sites they were going to. T. H. Erickson, 1995. The world has changed quite dramatically since then. There now exist studies from the region one visit as ethnographer. New trends in ethnography. When we look at the autobiographical accounts of the ethnographers, we notice that changes have come in fieldwork objectives, techniques and styles. Palto and Palto, Ibid, make the following generalizations about recent trends in the contemporary ethnographic work. First, quantification of field observations and increasingly sophisticated operationalizing of field data have become more usual in ethnographic investigation than they were earlier. Much ethnographic research is now focused on urban social systems, complex segments of peasant societies and other types of non-primitive literate populations. The study of social change, modernization and social processes looms large in contemporary research, partly overshadowing earlier concerns with static, equilibrated social and cultural systems. The tendency of ethnographer to identify with their people and to find positive values in their cultural practices has continued, but more and more anthropologists now go beyond these passive partitionships, seeking to foster social changes that would improve the socioeconomic situation of their research communities. This trend is related to a series of ethical questions. In connection with the tendency to press for social action, some contemporary ethnographers are beginning to see themselves as carrying out research for the local communities themselves, rather than simply for their academic peers and perhaps for governmental agencies. Thus, anthropologists have assumed the responsibility of making their research results relevant for and available to the people whose ways of life they have studied. Although there continues to be a larger number of general descriptive ethnographic studies, many field workers focus their data gathering on the specialized aspect of socio-cultural system or on some theoretical problem. A general ecological orientation is becoming more common in ethnographic work, bringing with it a much needed re-emphasis on physical and biological environment. Self-conscious concern and writing about the techniques of field research must also be considered a significant characteristic of the contemporary ethnographic scene. Autobiographical accounts of field experience are a recent phenomenon. Complex ethical and practical questions are posed by anthropologists. Involvements in research related to American foreign policy, involvement of some anthropologists in the ongoing war in Afghanistan is a case in point. It generated heated debate in American Anthropological Association, and the majority censored such anthropologists. Global and multi-sited ethnography, globalization is now impacting the entire world. It poses a challenge to the existing social scientific methods of inquiry and units of analysis by destabilizing the embeddedness of social relations in human groups and places. It thus poses problems for ethnography, upsetting ethnographers' claim to understand social relations by being there, and thus demands that the practitioners of ethnography rethink the character of global ethnography. Ethnographic sites are now globalized by means of various external connections across multiple spatial scales and porous and contested boundaries. The extension of the site in the time and space poses conceptual and practical problems for ethnographers. However, by locating themselves firmly with the time and space of social actors living the global, ethnographer can reveal how global processes are collectively and politically constructed, demonstrating the variety of the ways in which globalization is grounded in the local and how the social becomes transnational. Thus, a global ethnography may be taken as the response of the ethnographers to the impact of globalization process that has engulfed all the regions of the world. Traditional ethnography typically situates a researcher's ethnographer in one field or one site for a long period of time. The researcher does not move across many spaces and thus gets to know one setting extremely well. Differing from the traditional ethnography, multi-sited ethnography follows a research topic across numerous spaces for shorter periods of time. Thus, multi-sited ethnography may be described as a method of data collection that follows a topic or social problem through different field sites geographically and or socially. George Marcus, 1995, proposed multi-sited ethnography as a way to examine global processes and the increasing interconnection and the increasing interconnectedness of all people through the process of globalization. Marcus maintains that multi-sited ethnography solves the need for a method to analytically explore transnational processes, groups of peoples in motion, and ideas that extend over multiple locations. Since multi-sited ethnography is concerned with movement of ideas, people, and commodities, it is closely related to a world systems theory. It is closely related to a world system theory influenced by Immanuel Wallerstein, which views capitalism as a process without geographical boundaries. He argues that multi-sited ethnography allows for a macro-level understanding of a topic. It allows researchers to understand a variety of perspectives. It also enhances our understanding of how power structures from seemingly disconnected spaces ultimately impact a specific population. On a macro level, policies of one nation impacts people in another. The obvious limitation of the multi-sited ethnography is that it has multiple sites and thus prevents researchers from getting to know one site in depth. And if a researcher does not get to know a site in depth, the quality of the data may not be as good as the researcher expects. Managing access to the multiple sites can also be challenging. Moreover, when using multi-sited ethnography to compare different groups' answer to the same research questions, there may be problems in obtaining comparable data and difficulties related to translation and cultural appropriateness of question asked. Summary. At the last, we will discuss about the conclusion or summary. Now we are going to discuss the summary. Ethnography literally means a portrait of a people. It is a written description of a particular culture, the customs, beliefs, and behavior based on information collected through fieldwork. Thus, it is an art of describing a group or culture. It may be conducted in an exotic setting, among a primitive tribal group, peasant village, in an urban setting, or in an industrial organization. When used as a method, it refers to a fieldwork based on participant observation by an individual who lives with and tries to live like those who are studied. It is usually for a year or more to observe the behavior of people in different seasons. People's behavior should be studied in everyday context rather than under experimental conditions created by the researchers. Data may be gathered from a range of sources, but observation and informal conversations are the best and most effective way. Key informants play the most important role, and hence they are to be selected wisely and used carefully and intelligently. Building trust and support at an entry stage is the most crucial, as this will facilitate or ensure the success of an ethnographic exercise. Ethnographic research usually produces a large amount of qualitative data. Ethnographic research does not usually start from a definite theory. It starts with data and usually without a hypothesis. Thus, analysis and interpretation became very important. Analysis turns raw data into cooked data and results are obtained. Theoretically, there is no end to an ethnographic research and is often determined by the time and resources available. Reflection. Though hundreds of ethnographic accounts are available from all over the world, we may have a look at some of the best known ones from different parts of the world and India that would be taken up in this course. First, Argonauts of the Western Pacific by Bronislaw Malinowski. The Newer by Evans Pritchards. The Forest of Symbols, Aspects of Dambu Ritual, N-D-E-M-B-U, Dambu Ritual by Victor Turner. Death in Banaras by Jonathan Perry. Coming of Age in Samoa by Margaret Mead. Political Systems of Highland Burma, A Study of Kachin Social Structure by Edmund Leach. Neither Men Nor Women, The Hijras of India by Sarina Nanda. India's Changing Villages by S.C. Dubé. Religion and Society Among the Coots, C-W-R-G-S, Coots of South India by M.N. Srinivas. Himalayan Polyandry by D.N. Mazumdar. Thank you so much.